This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world. Today we have with us a guest who has made a number of very popular appearances on Dreamland. If you're a Coast listener, you know her well. Welcome, Catherine Austin Fitz, publisher of the Solari Report, to Dreamland. Glad you're back with us, Catherine.
It's always a delight to do Dreamland, because then this is what I say to all my favorite hosts, then I get to talk to you.
Oh, well, how nice. That's lovely to hear. Of course, we're here in California, and I am right now in Santa Monica, a few miles south of Malibu, where, oddly enough, most of my friends live. I have more friends in Malibu than I do in Santa Monica. Of the 11 people I know well there, 7 of them have lost their homes, and the rest are all either damaged or have gotten through it okay or don't know. So
right.
That's kind of where that is. Let's talk a little bit about California and what might be going on here. I know you have some thoughts about this, so why don't you just kind of give us an overview and we'll take it from there.
When the fires started in Napa and Mendocino in the area north of San Francisco, I guess it was October 2017, I had many subscribers in that area, and I started to get significant numbers of emails from people who were simply grappling with what so many anomalies that were going on, things that were not compatible with the theory that these were wildfires. Now, of course, we know California's been in terrible drought, so the possibility and probability of fires is not to be discounted whatsoever. But they were experiencing such strange things. So you're getting these flashes from, like a laser bolt coming from the sky. You're getting environments where there's no wind, and all of a sudden, the fires start and the winds are significantly greater very quickly in a way that doesn't make any sense. You have fires that are much hotter than the typical wildfire house fire. So for example, for many years I had recommended to people that they get, if they asked me, what kind of safe do I need? I would say you need something that can withstand 1,400 degrees. Well, suddenly, we're seeing fires where it looks like you need something that can withstand 2,000. It's a very different, investment and setup. So I thought, oh, good Lord, is everybody's precious metals melting? What is going on here? And law enforcement firefighters reported, very strange goings on. So literally, you'd see a fire in a house at the top of the hill burn down. But there was no fire around it, so all the trees down the and around the, lower on the hill would be untouched. You'd see many, many houses with the houses all burnt down, but the trees untouched and the utility poles untouched. So you just kept getting these very strange behaviors and, and inexplicable patterns. And I remember I was getting email for about a week and a half, Whitley, and then something came in. I forget what it was. I think it was the story of a policeman in Napa who suddenly was he was sitting in his car. The town had been evacuated, just making sure the town was empty. And then suddenly a fire erupted in front of him like Moses in the burning bush, and there was no fire around. There was nothing to cause it. It was just like, there's no fire and suddenly
out of nowhere.
Right.
Yeah.
So what started was a process of tremendous speculation, and it's what I call the unanswered questions phase, where people know that the official story isn't compatible with the facts and evidence, but that doesn't mean we know what's going on. And so you go through this process of unanswered questions. And, the attacks from the trolls of, oh, you're a conspiracy theorist, is designed to make sure that process of asking questions and exploring you know, possible hypotheses cannot happen. Because that's how humans figure this out. You know, it's like a jigsaw puzzle, and we, you know, we put down our pieces and we play with them and we try and figure out, you know, how things work. And on anything this big or complex, it takes a long, long time. Well, so going back to where I was in October 2017, this last piece of evidence came in, and I did something, Whitley, I've never done before in my life, and I'm a person who's dealt with, you know, a lot of bad news. I dealt with serious litigation and physical harassment and surveillance. You know, I've dealt with a lot of tough stuff, and I'm not a stranger to violence. Well, I read it, and I got up, walked into the bathroom, and threw up. And because what I realized is, look, that, you know, the U.S. airspace is controlled by the U.S. military. So if you look at, I don't begin to understand what technology could be used to cause these fires, whether it's, you know, some people say laser, some people say directed energy weapons, some people say, you know, there's other technology, and I don't begin to understand any of it. But, you know, the U.S. military controls U.S. airspace, so there's only one way this stuff could be happening, and that is doing it. Or one of their contractors. The U.S. military is simply standing down, saying it's California, it's not our business. And the other possibility is they can't stop it. Now, I don't know which one is true, but, you know, one of those, to me, is, you know, 99% chance that one of those three hypotheses is true. And all of them are deeply disturbing.
They are deeply disturbing, and there's, in a way, there's something a bit more to it than that. And the, what I mean by that is this, that the one of the holy grails of weapons development for the past, especially 25 or 30 years, has been energy pulse weapons.
Right.
And there exists a video, a 30-second video on YouTube that shows an energy pulse moving up from below past what appears to be a UFO, which darts out of the way, taken from the space shuttle. And this video is... it's a baffling video. It's been there for a long time. I think it's been there for a couple of years, since 2007, in fact. And there's been a lot of analysis of this video. But here's the bottom line on it. Whether the UFO was an alien spacecraft or a target that was intentionally designed to try to evade this thing or what exactly was going on, it's impossible to say. But what it is possible to say is that a clear, visible pulse of energy comes up from below. Where it comes from specifically is the Pine Gap Reservation, U.S. military reservation in Australia. So that was where it was being tested. Ours. Now, we're not alone on planet Earth. The United States has some friends and some enemies, most notably Russia, China, North Korea, Iran, all of which would conceivably have motives to do something like this. So I don't think it's at all possible. In fact, it's deeply concerning. It has nothing to do with conspiracy theories when people say they saw a laser, what looked like a beam of light coming down from above.
Right.
Because putting a thing like that on a satellite and then doing things to harm the United States economy makes a lot of sense if you do want the United States economy harmed.
Right.
So, now that said, I have actually seen a wildfire break out on a roadside here in California, and it was, frankly, the most amazing thing I've ever seen. And the reason it was like what happened was, I don't know exactly what caused the fire. I did not see it start, but it was burning as we were driving along the highway. And the next thing, literally, I knew there was a kind of gully and then a hillside with some trees on it. Really, within, I would say, under 30 seconds, there was a strip of grass burning on the highway. Then moments later, the fire was in the trees, and the trees just exploded like bombs.
Right, and it's that dry. Now, we're talking about an environment which is very, very dry after 7 years of drought. And one thing I'll mention, there's a wonderful video of Mark McClandish testifying in front of the Mount Shasta County Commissioners. It was arranged, it was a sort of testimony on geoengineering. And he describes the extent to which these, you know, metal and aluminum particulates in the spring, as they collect on the trees, as they collect on the, you know, all living things, it creates something that creates a fire that's much faster and harder to put out. And anybody who's experiencing significant fires, I always encourage them to get their fire department or volunteer fire department to watch that, so that they understand there's, you know, chemically there's something else going on here than a normal fire.
Yeah, well, that it would appear to have been the case in Malibu. I have friends who stayed because they have their house contains millions of dollars worth of art and rare books. And it has got its own external sprinkler system. They did not evacuate. They stayed with the house, which was always their plan, because they do have this system that's very expensive. It's not something that a normal house would have. And they described to me the experience as their most of their neighborhood went up in flames. One of those fire tornadoes went down the middle of the street, and within just a matter of seconds, one whole side of the street was burning that hadn't been burning before.
Right.
It is, and it just makes you
like an explosion.
Like an explosion. It's like an explosion. And I think they were very courageous to stay there, and the two of them, it's just a couple. Everyone else in the neighborhood had evacuated. They actually saved a number of homes besides their own simply by going and putting out little fire spots that would appear here and there and preventing the fire from spreading from those spots. But still, there are two things here. One is this possibility that it could be some kind of military action, not us. I mean, I am not that kind of a conspiracy theorist at all.
I agree that it's a very small chance that it's the U.S. military. So, you know, yeah. But whenever I discuss scenarios, I always talk about, you know, all the possibilities, even if it's a tiny percent.
Right.
Well, but the reality is the military can't not know. I mean, they cannot.
Well, that's the
There's no
thing.
Way the Defense Intelligence Agency and ONI don't know what's going on.
And when we get back, we're going to be talking a little bit more about secrecy and classification and how it helps and how it hurts in relation, especially to the rapidly changing world in which we live. We'll be right back.
Aloha, Jeremy Vaney here, and I want to tell you about my latest undertaking, OurUndoing.com. OurUndoing.com is a multimedia website where if you watch, if you read, if you listen, without trying to absorb knowledge like we do with normal learning, and without the normal judgmental filters that we use to compare and contrast so-called spiritual knowledge, if we watch, if we read, if we listen without all of that, we may just wake up to our full human nature. That is what this website is for. It's not about what we're doing, it's about who we are, truly are, when we're off the pendulum of duality. If your life is about seeking truth above all else, look no further. Join me at OurUndoing.com.
The afterlife revolution is getting great reviews. There's a tremendous, lovely response to it, and I'm so pleased and humbled, because it's an effort on the part of myself and Anne, and I love Anne so much. I want her to succeed in this incredible task that she has undertaken of returning and communicating across the bridge between the worlds, and she's really doing it. This is a real thing that's happening. Listen to some of these reviews. Anne and Whitley Strieber lay out their life's work in the most exquisitely beautiful manner. This moving book comes from the heart, the unified heart of two people who have dedicated their lives in this realm and the next to revealing the nature of consciousness as it makes its sojourn in this human form. That's just one. Here's another. I love, love this book. It's a wonderful read, especially if you lost somebody very close to you. Just incredible. Here's another one. The book shows you how to grow your soul, for lack of a better term. Through Anne's insight, Whitley shares invaluable information that could only be from the other side. So take it seriously. Go to Amazon and get Afterlife Revolution. Go on to Amazon and get the Afterlife Revolution in paperback or in Kindle format. And if you have questions or thoughts, write me at whitley@strieber.com. I'm right here. I'm ready to answer anything you ask to help you in any way I can, always. We're talking to Catherine Austin Fitz of the Solari Report, publisher of the Solari Report, solarireport.com. I am sure that most of you are familiar with Catherine and her work, but if not, do go to solarireport.com. I am one of the lucky people who gets the Solari Report, which is why I am always informed in what I would describe as uniquely useful ways. Why don't you tell us, before we go on, about what you're dealing with in this, in the current report, and what you're working on?
Well, the hard copy we're just mailing is the second quarter report, which is The Rise of the Asian Consumer, which is essentially to help our subscribers understand the literally explosive presence in their life of all things Asian, whether it's the competition economically from Asia or the movement of Asian capital or Asian people into their areas. It's quite remarkable because this is a process which has been going on for 20 years, but it's simply now just going up the S-curve. So the Asian middle class in 12 years is projected to be literally more than 10 times the U.S. middle class. And so, you know, it's quite dramatic because you see the incomes in Asia converging towards the United States. And, of course, this development of sort of explosive growth in Asia is happening at the same time, Whitley, that we have other explosive changes happening, particularly AI and robotics. And so we're talking about change at an unprecedented speed,
right,
in multiple areas of everybody's life. Yeah. So what we try to do with our wrap-ups is focus on all the different primary, we call them primary investment trends, that are going to have really deep, lasting impact on all of us. And so the rise of the Asian, to me, the three big ones in this decade. One is AI and robotics, one is space, and the other is the rise of Asia. And that's, if you go back this year, our annual wrap-up was on pension funds. Then our first quarter was space-based economy. This one is second quarter that we're just mailing now, the hard copy, is rise of the Asian consumer. And then the third quarter wrap-up, and I'm just working to do the audio for the major theme this Thursday night, is megacities. And, of course, megacities is very tied into the rise of Asia because you've got we now have 47 megacities worldwide. A megacity is defined as a city with more than 10 million people. So we now have 47 worldwide, 30 of which are in Asia.
My word, I did not realize that. A city of more than 10 million people, like, I guess, well, Tokyo would be one? Or
Tokyo is the largest city in the world with 38 million people. You know, the first megacity was New York City. We only have two megacities, you know, New York and Los Angeles.
Right.
China has 30. India has 6. And the three biggest ones are in Asia. You know, Tokyo is with 38 million is significantly bigger than L.A. I know it doesn't feel that way, Whitley, since you're out there in the L.A. area.
Oh, when you're in Tokyo, it feels that way because, folks, if you have not been to Tokyo, there are two things that will happen when you go to Tokyo. One is you'll realize the extent to which you don't understand Japanese at all in any way whatsoever, even though you did think on the plane that you were learning it. Number two, you will discover they did not invest in street signs in Tokyo. There are none, or very, very few. And that combination of things will make you a sort of micro-tourist.
Wow.
Have you been to Tokyo? Surely you have.
You know, I've been to Tokyo, but I've never been inside of Tokyo. I've been in the Tokyo airport.
Oh, I see. Well, the other thing is that Tokyo was not a planned city. It's like London. It's just like a sort of spaghetti bowl of little streets.
Mm-hmm.
And life in Tokyo is extremely microcosmic. You will live in, if you live in Tokyo, as I have some friends who did, they recently moved back to this country, you will live in your own neighborhood, basically within walking distance of your house. It's where you will be. And the rest of Tokyo is almost unknown to you, except
right.
the big, you know, city center landmarks.
Well, in many respects, New York is surprisingly that way. Because when one New Yorker asks another New Yorker where they live, they need to know the block.
Yeah.
Because remember, a block in New York is $1 billion GNP. A block economically is huge.
Huge. It's amazing. Amazing,
isn't it? It's amazing, yeah.
But let's go on. Now, we sort of moved away from the fires and the an important issue. I think it's quite important. When the president announced the new military space force. People laughed and said, "Oh, you know, he's tilting at windmills," and I thought, "No, he is not." And I think you can tell us exactly why that's important, and we will come when we come back. We'll talk about that.
Okay.
You've probably heard the music for years. It's the theme song for Dreamland. But you may not know the name of the piece, The O of Pleasure. Or the name of the composer, Ray Lynch. Ray Lynch is a 3-time Billboard Award winner. Ray is also the composer of the platinum album, Deep Breakfast. Pandora calls Ray one of the most influential artists in New Age pop and adult alternative circles. For music that will move your heart and set your spirit soaring, visit www.raylynch.com.
War Day is one of Whitley Strieber's most powerful books. Join him and his co-author Jim Konietka as they travel across the United States devastated by limited nuclear war. This acclaimed novel was originally published in the 1980s, but now that North Korea has said that they can hit the U.S. with nukes, it's more timely than ever. Don't miss this informative, exciting, and convincing testament to the power of the human spirit in challenging times like our own. Get the ebook for $3.99. Go to Strieber.com for this and all of Whitley's great books.
We're talking to Catherine Austin Fitz, publisher of the Solari Report. Go to SolariReport.com to learn more. I'm a subscriber to the Solari Report, and it is a very important part of my life because it clarifies things extraordinarily well. Catherine can be described charitably as an real expert in the way the world works. And later on, we're going to be talking about the challenge of artificial intelligence and the other great challenges of robotics, what happens to jobs, what happens to the meaning of human life. And we're going to get into that more deeply later. But right now, we're going to talk a little bit about the president's space force and why a president with access to intelligence briefings and the intelligence community might conclude that this was an important direction to go in.
You know, this is an area, Willie, as you know, where it's very hard to get good intelligence. But there are a growing number of people who believe that after the Kennedy assassination, a high percentage of the U.S. space activities were taken classified or dark, and that the growth in that area has been much more significant than most people understand. And the role of space in terms of offensive and defensive surveillance and weaponry has been much more important than most people understand. So space is a critical issue in terms of both control of the planet and control of the economy and economic activity and life on planet Earth. And I suspect that one of the reasons that we're now seeing a significant capital moved into private hands for the purpose of building out more space programs, this time on a private basis, and including economic activities like asteroid mining. And I think the president, as a politician, knows how important it is that you have something that captures the imagination of the entire general population and gets them to support what's happening in space, that it's not just a corporate activity, but it's an activity that attracts the best and the brightest. So he's trying to do a little bit of a Kennedy thing, which is, you know, just as Kennedy tried to excite people's imagination about the possibilities of space, he's trying to do the same thing. And what he understood, because I have to tell you, if I was Secretary Mattis or any of the generals, I'd be really frustrated, because the last thing you want to do when you're trying to sort of build up excellence is to stop and reorganize. Reorganizing is very time-consuming and painful in Washington. At the same time, I think the president's right. You need a way of capturing the imagination of the general population, getting them to support them, which is why I think he announced, you know, he decided to make the whole process more visible and popular, is what I think he was trying to do. And, you know, there's no doubt in the end he's trying to recruit the best and the brightest to support, you know, to support it and look for job opportunities there.
And of course, it is reminiscent in many respects of the old Star Wars project from the Reagan administration that kind of went nowhere, largely because of the fact that it was an immediate technological application that had to be developed from the ground up. And this looks more like an organizational process than it does based on a single critically important weapon system. So it might actually work. And my concern is this, and this is what friends of mine would poo-poo me and say, oh, that's the most ridiculous thing. I said, it's nothing ridiculous about it. Every time you turn on your GPS, this idea of protecting our space infrastructure is not ridiculous, because the destruction of that infrastructure would be all too easy.
But the economy is completely dependent on, at this point, on the satellite system and the suborbital platform.
That's absolutely right.
Right. Everything we do is based on satellites. And what's interesting is, you know, to me, one of my predictions is one of the companies that will be the wealthiest at the end of the 21st century is the guy who figures out the how to economically and successfully deal with space debris, because the, you know, the safety issues are not just from ill-intended players. The safety issues are, you know, we now have a traffic jam up there.
Yes.
So yeah, I think this is important. The one thing I would like to bring up, and this takes us back into the California fires, we have a lot of non-state actors who look to have more and more significant capacity, including in the skies. And, you know, I hate to bring up the old James Bond movies, but we're running into non-state actors that have a lot more power, including military power, than state actors.
Well, exactly. And non-state actors who have not only, but critically, also much more flexibility.
Right.
They don't have the constraints that even a state like China might have. They're not constrained in that way. They function from the top down, and the chairman of the board system And board of director system is very efficient. That's why corporations often work so efficiently and so smoothly. Not
right.
always.
So one possible scenario you have in California is you have the military standing down or not able to stop a non-state actor from doing this.
Who do you think might be a possible example, or is that too impossible a question to address?
So you know Richard Dolan's concept of the breakaway civilization.
Yes, I do.
So I think you have, you know, think of the breakaway civilization as a group in the deep state who just, you know, completely decided to build a separate civilization. So, you know, and you can even describe the deep state as that way. I think you've got, you know, one or more breakaway civilizations who could be doing it.
Well, you know, I would not believe in a thing like the breakaway civilization, except I had a run-in with it once. And I am not going to go into the details, but suffice to say that it involved children, and it was completely startling. It was
right.
astonishing.
Right.
And there's no question about the fact that there is something there that we do not see that involves, in this particular case, must involve something as straightforward as domestic life.
Right.
And, you know, people will always say, where is it? And the answer is really very straightforward. If the breakaway civilization exists, it's not hidden. It's right here. In plain
right.
sight, all around
right.
us.
Right.
It just does not advertise itself at all.
Right. Well, if you've ever watched Stanley Kubrick's last movie, Eyes Wide Shut, you know, you get a glimpse of it.
Yeah. You know, that is a very much underrated but extremely important movie. Stanley Kubrick had an insight into a reality that we don't generally believe even exists in that movie.
Well, I don't know if you've ever heard the story. When I was Assistant Secretary of Housing, it was relatively early in my stint. This is in 1989. And Jack Kemp was the Secretary of HUD. And we had, I'll never forget it because the day was his birthday. And we had a meeting with the regional administrators. At the time, there were 10 federal regions. There are fewer now. And there were 10 regional administrators, so it was the 10 HUD regional administrators. And the one from California had done something that Kemp was very irritated about. So we have this meeting. It lasted about 2 hours. It was the 10 regional administrators, Kemp, myself, and some of the other, it's called principal staff. And for about an hour straight, Jack had a temper tantrum. And just screamed at the California administrator. And
that would be
point,
an interesting experience to be in front of an hour-long temper tantrum, but go ahead.
It was the most unbelievable thing to watch. You know, I used to have the White House, somebody from the White House call me and ask me if basically, you know, Kemp was having meltdowns. So they knew it was a problem. Anyway, so Kemp is furious and he's screaming, and the California administrator says, "But Mr. Secretary, I had to do it. It's the law." And Kemp just exploded. You could see steam coming out of both sides of his head. And he said, "The law? The law? I don't have to obey the law. I report to a higher moral authority." And he was dead serious, Whitley. And I literally realized, okay, it's, you know, he's talking about the Eyes Wide Shut guys. And you could see his... At that moment, he just felt such disdain that anybody would think that he had to obey the formal laws. And he and his group were like that. They just believed that they had, you know, authorization to do all these different things that were completely in violation of the law. And it was fine because they had directives from much higher.
Free Dreamlanders, we're going to take another little break here for you. Subscribers, as always, we're keeping on keeping on. And the new website is headed our way. I've been looking at it, and we're beginning to test it in detail. I will not tell you where it is, but it is working well, really well, and it will soon be up. We'll be right back.
Whitley Strieber has published an incredible 2-volume historical novel called In Hitler's House under his open pseudonym Jonathan Lane. This amazing story follows the life of William Weber, who meets Hitler while touring Germany in 1931 and becomes his friend and confidant, but then, when he realizes the truth, becomes a spy in Hitler's house for the Allies. Living a life of terrible danger, he falls in love with another of Hitler's secret friends, also a spy in his house. This is a story of espionage and desperate love, and the deepest portrait of Adolf Hitler ever created. Don't miss In Hitler's House, available in paperback and as an ebook on Amazon.
This is Whitley Strieber. We're talking to Catherine Austin Fitz of the Solari Report, solarireport.com. As you can tell from the wide-ranging areas of expertise Catherine touches on and is touching on just during this one interview, there's something of real value there. And if you start getting into the Solari Report, go to the website and take a look around. It's an amazing place, and because she will not just turn away from the kind of edgy subjects that interest us and that we think may be important. She looks right at them. And in apropos of that, I'll just mention another sort of deep state experience I had back in the early 90s. A group of senators were asking me to help them formulate questions for the intelligence community that would lead to answers that would give them some kind of an idea of what was really going on in the world of UFOs. And these senators were in a committee that had the right to ask those questions. And so I was trying to help them. And it turned out, I kept saying that the key thing, though, is to follow the money. These questions can go on forever, but you need to follow the money.
Right.
And by God, if they didn't find an entire military base manned by what appeared to be U.S. soldiers being paid with checks that looked like they were from the United States Treasury Department, but it didn't exist. It wasn't on the books anywhere.
Right. There's a lot of that, Whitley.
Yeah, I know. And, you know, and the secretary, I believe it was Secretary of State has came out and muttered right before 9/11 that the Pentagon had lost $1 trillion.
Yeah, Secretary of Defense.
That's right. Yeah.
I don't know if you know this, but 3 days later, I was working as a researcher to help a reporter who's about to break a cover story that Friday in Insight magazine on the missing money. At that point, the number was almost $4 trillion. And I said to her on Monday after Rumsfeld did it, we just assumed it was a modified hangout to get ahead of the Friday story. I said to the reporter, nothing can stop this story from going mainstream now. Well, famous last words.
Yeah, famous last words. That story is like a campfire that won't stay lit.
It's really interesting. It keeps I would say it's like the eternal flame. It keeps coming back, even when the cat, you know, urinates on it. Anyway, I don't know if you heard the latest on the missing money. This finally got so significant, we put up a website called missingmoney.solari.com. You can link to it from solari.com. But it has a full history of the missing money and all the, you know, there's been a remarkable amount of press. But I don't know if you heard the last one. Dr. Skidmore, a full professor from Michigan State University in state and local finance, did a survey with his students, his graduate students, and identified, you know, I had the number up to $12 trillion. And Skidmore heard me on the radio, and I had pointed out that the missing money in 2015, so the last full year of Obama, was $6.5 trillion. And he thought I made a mistake. Anyway, he did a survey with his students, and they took it up to $21 trillion. He wrote a report and, you know, kind of rocketed around the Internet, because at that point, Whitley, it was the undocumentable adjustments were more than the outstanding debt of the United States, which is sort of an interesting parallel. And then the DOD came out and said, oh, we're going to do an audit, made a big to-do about we're going to do an audit. Now, this has happened many times before when they've said, oh, we're going to do an audit, and then nothing ever happens. Anyway, so it turns out they go to the Federal Accounting Standards Advisory Board, and the auditor said, you know, we got a problem. If we do this audit, it's going to show up classified projects. So the advisory board came back and promulgated a preliminary policy and then a final policy that's now gone final. You can read about it at the missingmoney.salary.com. It said the Department of Defense, using people who we don't know who the people are, by a process we don't know what the process is, can classify whatever they want and move it into a separate books and not disclose it. Now, what that means is there is no disclosure. There's no accounting.
None.
And they can do whatever they want. Now, this is in complete violation of the Constitution, of all the financial management laws and regulation. It's just completely, you know, so the Federal Accounting Standards Advisory Board doesn't have the legal authority to promulgate this policy. You know, and that policy doesn't give the Department of Defense or the U.S. Treasury the legal, you know, authority to then, you know, engage in illegal transactions, nor does it give the New York Fed member banks as depository for the U.S. government the authority to do those illegal transactions. But they're all pretending that it does.
Yeah, and pretending that you're following the law is exactly what happened in ancient Rome.
Right.
After Augustus Caesar took over, and he created the appearance that he was the following the law and was the sort of head, the chief senator, and respecting the law and so forth, when he was actually a dictator.
Well, but here's the problem. You know, running the federal government of the United States is a very complex, difficult thing to do. And it's hard enough when there are clear written guidelines that everybody can share. When there are no laws and the process, the economic process is out of the law, outside the law, you then have the most powerful financial mechanism ever created by man operating on an out-of-control basis, and everybody's fighting like crazy to control the pork flow, because the pork flow is enormous. Now, it gets worse because the National Security Advisor Director and the President delegated to the National Security Director can waive the application of SEC rules to any defense contractor doing classified work with that pot of money. So now we've created a financial vehicle that can spend an infinite amount of undisclosed money through private corporations who don't have to report where they got that money when they announce their earnings, you know, or lever that money with in the stock market. And so we now have a stock market that is full of secret money for which there's no transparency and which, you know, those contractors are allowed to play who knows what games, and the SEC isn't going to do bo peep about it. So whether it's the Treasury securities market, which is the biggest securities market in the world, or the U.S. stock market, which is the largest stock market in the world, we don't know what the numbers mean. They're meaningless.
Right. We really don't. And what, the other, that, and then that gets me to the whole concept of fiat currency. Money is valuable because we believe in it. That
right.
It is, in other words, money is now completely an act of faith, but it's not possible to go do something like go on the gold standard, because there isn't nearly enough gold to cover all of the money that we would need. Not nearly enough.
So, well, in theory, if we were capable of creating trustworthy systems, which we're obviously not right now, you know, you could figure out a way to use gold or a gold standard or other kind of hard asset standards. But the problem is, if you tried to use gold right now, it would just turn into fiat gold.
That was my point. Exactly.
Right, exactly. Exactly. So we've got a situation where there are no markets, there is no price discovery, and, you know, the largest securities in the markets in the world have disclosure, which is meaningless. Now, I shouldn't say all meaningless, because, you know, there are plenty of companies who are not involved in classified projects. And,
yes.
And which we can be reasonably assured, you know, are not pumping through, you know, tons of illegal earnings.
But the thing is, there are so many companies that are, because what has happened is that this system, which President Eisenhower warned us about so
right.
so presciently all those years ago has become bigger than what we can see.
Right. Well, that's the thing. The covert economy is overwhelming. I think the message of the California fires is the covert economy is overwhelming the overt economy, and they now feel confident enough to just proceed brazenly in the open. One reason I believe that's the case, that our third quarter wrap-up in 2017, Whitley, was called Control 101 and was all on mind control. And I think if there's any, you know, for quite a long time, the greatest controlling, the most powerful controlling system was money and finance. I think mind control is now surpassing money and finance, and the two in combination are lethal. But the mind control technology, the digital technology has made possible, is quite significant.
Let's talk about that a little bit. I think you and I both know a fair amount about it, but I want to hear what you have to say, because you might know a fair amount more.
Well, I'm not, you know, I go back again, I've had various scientists brief me on this and how it works, and the scientific information kind of goes in one ear and out the other. I can't explain to you scientifically how it works, but I've certainly experienced it enough. I had it used on me by phone during the litigation, and then I was investigating Enron and came to the conclusion that they were using entrainment during the investment analyst presentations. And then shortly thereafter, or a couple years thereafter, I had it used on me at an investment conference in New Orleans.
What was it? What was it like to have it used on you?
Well, you know, it was interesting. I walked into the ballroom, and I felt this wave of sort of synthetic pleasure, and I realized, oh my God, they're using entrainment technology.
Now, what is entrainment technology?
Entrainment technology. We have a great Salier report on entrainment technology and subliminal programming. So I'm going to give you my very stupid understanding. We've made it public, so I recommend you read the transcript. But entrainment technology makes you feel good and opens you up, and then subliminal programming comes in. So it's kind of a 1-2 punch. One makes you susceptible, and the other, you know, gets you to believe something. Anyway, so I walk into this auditorium, and Dick Armey's speaking, and everybody's clapping and cheering. There are about 1,000-plus people. And it's just, you know, you just feel wonderful. You just feel high. If you've ever swum with the whales, it was like a junk synthetic version of swimming with the whales. And so I remember thinking, I've got to really, manage my mind here, because they're using this technology. And I sit down, and I was taking notes, and I got really focused on finishing writing the next sentence of notes. And all of a sudden, I dropped my pencil and started clapping with everybody else and turned to my neighbor and said, "Isn't he wonderful?" And then I looked at my hands, and I said, "No, he's not wonderful. Why am I saying this?"
Wow.
So even knowing that it was happening, it still tricked me for a brief couple seconds. And
go ahead.
What was interesting was they were opening the audience was free to ask questions at the end of the speech. So Armey finished, and they passed around the microphone, and people could ask questions. And then George Tenet started to speak. And he had finished, he had left the CIA. He was the former head of the CIA when 9/11 happened. And so I realized, oh, my God, I'm going to be able to ask questions. This is just delicious. And so he gave a horrible speech, but everybody's clapping and saying, "Isn't he wonderful?" You know, because they felt high. And so I got up and I got the microphone. I couldn't believe it. I said, of course, he knows who I am. I said, "Mr. Tenet, this is Catherine Austin Fitz. My question for you is," his whole speech had been on why we needed new legislation to improve coordination between the Department of Justice, the Air Force, the different parts of the service, you know, because if on 9/11 we'd had that, everything would have worked. So I stood up and I said, "Mr. Tenet, can you explain why the Air Force stood down 4 times on 9/11? And he turned bright red. He was so angry, and you could see the steam coming out of his ear, and he said, you know, in political training, Whitley, we were taught, if you get a question you don't want to answer, just be very complimentary to the person asking the question, and then do a non sequitur. My dear, what a great question. Last Thursday it was rainy, and so I had my, you know, and you're just completely non sequitur. You don't, but you don't say anything nasty. So apparently he didn't get the training. He said, well, my dear, you know, very sarcastically, you might have noticed I was the head of the CIA, not the Air Force. You better ask the Air Force, which completely defied his notion of coordination or integration.
Do you have an idea? I don't want to pass this without, because my listeners are going to be saying to themselves, what does she think? So we weren't going to go there, but now that we are there, let's ask you, what do you think did happen? Why did they stand down? Because they certainly did. This quite clear from the record.
Well, here's the thing. The 9/11, the official story, is clearly not true, but it gets very complicated very fast to try and sort of ascertain what did happen. So, you know, I believe 9/11 was a false flag, and I believe that it had many different functions, but one of the functions was to destroy the trail on $4 trillion that was missing from the federal government, and a lot of the securities fraud that later, you know, forced the bailouts. So I would say 9/11 was the most profitable false flag in the history of the human race.
What she's talking about here is, we talked earlier about the fiat currency, and I mentioned that it is based on faith. And what she's talking about here, what Catherine, and I'm not putting, I'm sure, words in your mouth, folks, is preserving that faith.
Right.
Faith in a currency that is actually just paper.
Well, the other thing is, a decision was coolly made to try and start a war in the Middle East, and there was no, you know, there was no way to start a war in the Middle East. I'll give you an example. In church, the week before, for many years when I moved to Tennessee, what I found was there was remarkable coordination between the sermons I was getting at church and the leaks that the reporter I was working with in Washington would get from the FBI and CIA. And 2 days before 9/11, that Sunday, which was September 9th, I got a very, you know, political speech about how we, you know, the tension between the Christians and Islam had reached ahead, and the only way to solve was go to war. And so, you know, I discerned from the sermon that we were going to go to war in Afghanistan and then Iraq. And I went home and called the reporter and said, hey, we're going to war. So this is September 9th, Sunday. I said, we're going to war. We're going to attack Afghanistan, then we're going to go to Iraq, and then we're going to roll out. It was the, you know, Wesley Clark, 7 countries in 5 years. You know, so that we got that battle plan at church. And, you know, Wesley Clark got it at DOD, but a decision was made to go into the Middle East and basically occupy 7 countries in 5 years. And it looked to me like this was all part of doing 2 things, rounding up for a global currency and also, you know, sort of getting everybody into the BIS tent, but also plopping enough control on the Silk Road that a variety of different investment interests would be the lead investment interest on the build-out of the Silk Road.
Also, it's, you know, these wars they're really profit centers. I think that particularly an example is the difference between the war in Vietnam and the war in Afghanistan. In Vietnam, we sent thousands and thousands of young Americans to fight that war, and lost it because the public would not tolerate that, and they had to be brought home. However, over the next intervening years, we developed more and more efficient weapons so that one soldier could do the work of what now could do literally the work of many hundreds in Vietnam, could do in Vietnam in terms of firepower and effectiveness. So the result of this is that now we can have wars that are economically very important to the to those who profit from them, but don't cause enough casualties on the to our side to worry the public all that much. It's a perfect situation.
Well, I wouldn't say that because, you know, the majority of the soldiers are coming from seven southern states. And it worries those seven southern states pretty, you know, the pain has been enormous.
Well, that's interesting because it's, you know, the number of people who are, let me put it this way, on the first day of the Battle of the Somme, I believe there were 60,000 men killed.
Right.
And that's more than we have lost by a good long shot in the whole Middle Eastern adventure. So we're talking basically about a world that lives behind and underneath the world we live in. And it's a big world, and it's a very rich world.
Right.
And would you characterize us, those who are outside of this world, as still being free in the old sense of that word?
Well, I would say that freedom has deteriorated remarkably in my lifetime for most people. Now, there have always been checks and balances on freedoms. I'll never forget when I was targeted by the Department of Justice and going through, you know, an extraordinary experience. I said to somebody, you know, do you know anybody that this has happened to before? They said, yeah, we know a lot of people, but you're the first white one. Now, in fact, I wasn't the first white one. I did some research, but, you know, the beatdown on the African-American community had been pretty extensive for the prior 200 years. So, when I wanted to succeed at what I was doing, I went back to the African-American community, to the churches, to learn the spiritual warfare I needed to win. So the technology existed in the communities that have dealt, you know, the blacks call it the, when it happens to both individuals in the neighborhood, they call it the beatdown. So, you know, so a lot of people had been through the beatdown, but now it's spread. And I thought 9/11 was very important because that was the signal that said, you know, not only are they going to do it in black neighborhoods, they're going to blow up rich Wall Street bankers too. So, you know, it's definitely spread, and I'm sure the people in Malibu are feeling the craziness of the situation.
Oh, yeah. I can assure you they are.
Right. So when I wrote a book called Dylan Reed and the Aristocracy of Stock Profits. It's up at dylanreedandco.com on the web, or just do a search for Dylan Reed, you'll pick it up. And I described the fact that during the Clinton administration, SWAT teams under Eric Holder and Jamie Gorelick and their colleagues were being dropped into, you know, poor neighborhoods and rounding up innocent kids and throwing them into federal prisons so you could create a labor force that could be marketed to, you know, corporations for pennies on the dollar. You could, everybody would make money on their prison stocks or in prison construction, you know, so, as well as on the gentrification of the neighborhood. So you basically were pulling people off their land and putting them in slave labor camps. There was nothing we were doing that's any different than, you know, Hitler's slave labor camps, although my guess is the feds would probably say that the working conditions are better. Yeah, but
Well, that might be true, actually.
Right. But, the fundamentals of rounding up innocent people and throwing them in slave labor camps was absolutely the same. And I tried to communicate. I was amazed at how very few people were willing to support my efforts to bring transparency or do something about it. And I kept saying, you know, if they can do it to one, they can do it to all. And it's a matter, if you let this go down, it's a matter of time before, you know, they're perfectly happy to sweep or burn you off your land. And so, you know, it took 20 years, but it's coming full circle.
Yeah, and it is coming full circle. And it is a very, very, it's deeply concerning. And I'm going to segue, surprisingly, probably a little bit in terms of my listeners, into artificial intelligence from where we are now. And here's why. Back in the middle of the 20th, in the mid-20th century, the idea of planned economies became very popular on planet Earth. You had a planned economy in Russia and eventually also in China that eventually spread to half of Europe, and they didn't work. They were failures.
Right.
And they didn't work largely because of two things. One is the economies weren't efficient enough to supply the individual with everything he would like, not necessarily needed, but would like. Right. And that made him less and less motivated. And the reason for all of this was that the whole planning process, based as it was in an ideology that was fundamentally flawed, and flawed in a simple, straightforward way, that people would want to help others while they help themselves. And this is the idealism of Marxism that's simply false. Now, fast forward to the present time. You have a new system in place, artificial intelligence being applied to economic planning. And suddenly, everything changes. You don't have a lot of idiotic planners fumbling around, making guesses about how many telephone headsets might be needed, etc. You have somebody who knows for certain. And that somebody ain't human. Where do we go from there, Catherine? I mean, in the sense of ain't human, being me, I have to add, I mean artificial intelligence.
Well, here's the thing. The challenge of dealing with artificial intelligence, there are a couple of challenges. So let me just talk about the immediate phase we're in. The artificial intelligence we're facing is not an artificial intelligence who knows how to be like a human. It's simply deep learning. So, you know, it's sort of a neural network on steroids. And the most important ingredient to having the deep learning system of AI that succeeds is that you have the most data. So it's no longer necessary to have the smartest engineers. You just need the most data, because the most data can do the most analysis and protect, you know, create the most accurate result. And so right now, for the last 20 years, because of this, we've had a race to basically digitize everything. And I would even argue that the ionization of the sky in the spring is to get, you know, metal particles into all living things so you can literally digitize everything. And then you can run everything by AI. Now, the problem with all of this is that we're not so much dealing as an individual. I'm not dealing with an AI that's trying to optimize the whole planet's economy or environment. I'm dealing with 80,000 AIs, each that work for an organization that's got a very specialized goal. So let's say the NSA has a team of software AIs, you know, tracking me around and tracking me for whatever they want to know. But then they turn it over to their corporate contractors and they're selling it, or they're, you know, wanting it for a variety of consumer or other private purposes. And so imagine that you've got 80,000 stores with 80,000 AIs all trying to make money off of you.
Right.
There's nothing, you know, I've seen this in hospitals where you have 10 different services all cycling into a patient trying to book as many, you know, as many different surgeries or treatments or therapies or pharmaceuticals, you know, for their services possible, because that's how they make money. It's like they're trying to churn the patient. They're competing for being able to do more things for the patient because that's how they make money. So you're going to have all these AIs targeted trying to make money out of you, but they're really not, you know, they're not trained to optimize your situation or do it in a way that's energizing for you. And it's going to feel like, how do I describe it? You're going to feel like you're dealing with this swarm of psychopaths.
Yeah, that's exactly what it's going to feel like.
Right, you're being swarmed by psychopathic forces because they're incapable of, you know, integrating other processes. They're just out to optimize their own process, and they're incapable of kind of evolving. You know, in other words, their goal is to make money for store X.
Right.
Not, and they're not thinking straight. They're just you know, it's very focused.
Right. That, and that relentless focus is going to be horrendous, especially when it's not simply a store trying to get our attention, but, for example, when we get involved in governmental bureaucracies that are AI-driven and cannot get beyond that and and sink deeper and deeper into a morass from which there is no escape. Let me ask you a final question in closing. What do you say to a couple of 35 years old with two children about the future?
So here's what I say. Start with integrity and end with integrity. What you need to do is you need to make sure every person, every institution, every company, every bank, every organization you deal with has total integrity. The more you build your life on relationships that have integrity, the safer and the better off you'll be. So that's number one. Number two, we're going through a period of incredible change, which also means incredible opportunity, but you need to be able to rock and roll through it, and the way to do that is with faith, because ultimately this is spiritual warfare. So I'm not called to tell you what your faith should be or where you find it, but what I will tell you is faith is the substance of things hoped for but not yet seen. Faith is the building block of everything we build. So you're going to have to find your faith and use your faith to invent your world. That's how it works. And then the last thing I would say is don't worry about the bad guys. They're going to kill each other, which is why it's very important you avoid them in every possible way you can. Your time, your attention, your resources, get as far away as possible. You know, they'll kill each other. You don't want to be in the middle when they do.
Catherine Austin Fitz, publisher of the Solari Report. Take us on a terrific journey today, Catherine. Thank you so much.
Well, Whitley, it's always a pleasure to talk with you. I love your show. I love doing your show. I love having the opportunity to, you know, I feel like the two of us are deep diving, trying to really figure out what's at the core of this. And I just have to tell you, you know, if you were to join me and tootle into my den, I can't tell you how many Whitley Strieber books you would find there.
Good. Hear that, everybody? Fill your dens with Whitley Strieber books. You can't go wrong. Thanks, Catherine.
Have a great day.
You too.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by UnknownCountry.com and its family of subscribers. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host, and I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander. Thank you for listening.